For the next talk, we have approaching the diagnosis in pain syndromes, rheumatology perspective by Dr. Dharmanand, who is a consultant rheumatologist in Sakra World Hospital. Dr. Dharmanand is one of the senior most rheumatologists in the state. He did his graduation in Mysore Medical College, sorry, and his post-graduation from Madurai. He was one of the first people to finish DM in rheumatology and then start practice along with Dr. Chandrasekhar here in Bangalore. He's been trained in the UK as well between 2002 to 2004. He's the president of the Karnataka chapter of Indian Rheumatology Association as well as the secretary of the Indian Rheumatology Association. And now he's become the vice president. He's an inspiration to several rheumatologists, budding rheumatologists, and he's in charge of the fellowship as well in Sakra. Yeah. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, chairpersons. So let us slowly move to clinical aspects of pain. Both Dr. Vijaydas and Chandrasekhar have set a tone about what's pain. Pain is not, as you all know, that pain is not a simple symptom. It is a very, very complex symptom. And I will introduce you in the next 10, 15, 20 minutes to a broad outview of how to approach a pain, how do we approach a pain. And it's difficult to explain how to treat one particular pain, but I think this should empower you to think in a different way when you have a patient with pain. So initial thing is to differentiate whether the pain is acute or chronic, because these two are totally different species. The cause of acute pain, as you all know, it's generally well known. Acute is acute appendicitis or a fracture or a thorn prick or an injury, etc. In a chronic pain, many a times we don't know. Something, he fell down 1 year back in the bathroom, but he still complains of pain. It's not easy to explain that that injury, we all fall down and it doesn't have pain for years together. And duration is always short and usually well characterized. You know that this pain is going to last for X number of days. You had an injury, fracture, okay, for 1 week, 2 weeks, you'll have a pain and you have a cast and pain goes away. And in chronic pain, generally persist even after healing. Surgery is done, sutures have healed, the pain doesn't go away. And most of the time it lasts for more than 3 months. And the treatment approach is very simple. You have an abscess, you open the abscess, pus comes out, the pain is gone. You have a pimple, pimple breaks today and pain is gone. Your tooth is aching, something the dentist does to the tooth and pain is gone. It's fairly simple, the resolution of underlying cause, the pain is gone. But here, underlying cause, even if it is sometimes pretty difficult to identify what is underlying cause, and even if you deal with pain, may not go. So we may have to treat pain as pain. So this pain is a pain not only for the patient and the pain for the doctors as well. And outcome is often incomplete. We can manage the pain, but we never cure them of the pain, most of the chronic pains, particularly when it is the stage of chronic chronicity. So this is one basic broad concept we should have. So, but the patients also come to us with an acute model in their mind, because they have always had pain which has come and gone. They have gone to a nearby doctor, good friendly doctor, they have given some medicine, pain is gone. And they had, mother has applied some balm, pain is gone. So for them, the pain is manageable, curable. And as doctors also, we are all trained in medical model to find a cause, solve the cause, cure the patient. So when the patient comes back, the patient doesn't get better, the patient is annoyed. Last 1 year back I had pain, now it is gone, and it has gone. Now why this pain is not going? The doctor is incompetent, doctor is not able to diagnose me properly. That is how he is going to think. For the medical practitioner, the patient keeps coming back, I have done whatever I can, but why the patient is not going? I had a big spondylate disc. I have operated the disc, I have removed the disc, I have given him a perfectly nice looking x-ray and MRI. Patient pain doesn't get improved. So patient, doctors also are at a loss. So this is an important concept to remember. Other important concept is to differentiating different types of pain. The pain is pain in a broad sense, but the pain has a lot of flavors to it, lot of dimensions to it. So not all pains behave same, not all pains respond to a similar kind of management. So we need to know from the history, from the evaluation, whether we are dealing with what is called as a nociceptive pain. You know what is nociception from the first lecture. This also can be called as somatic pain. It is caused by an activity in the neural pathway in response to tissue damaging stimuli. So there is usually some injury or a trauma or an infection, something to initiate this process. It is generally localized. And the nature of pain is aching pain, dull aching pain or a throbbing type of pain. You remember the pain you have had when you had a tooth problem. It's like throb. You feel like it cropping inside is. And if you have a pus somewhere and an injury, that is the pain you have, this nociceptive pain. Or you suddenly had a catch when you lifted something. So that is a nociceptive pain. They are generally responsive to analgesics and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So that is an important law. Your pain responds well to your ibuprofen or diclofenac or whatever you give. That is likely to be a nociceptive pain. Contrast this to a neuropathic pain. It is initiated by problem in the nerves, either a damage in the nerve or dysfunction of the nerve. So nerve injury or damage is the basic physiology there. And this pain is not responsive to non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs or steroid, if you're thinking of inflammatory arthritis. So when your pain, your patient doesn't respond to your usual pain, comes with acute pain, burning pain, pain, you give him a diclofenac injection. You should expect some benefit. May not be 100% benefit all the time, some benefit. They don't respond to an adequate trial of NSAIDs or a steroid. Then start thinking, am I dealing with a different type of pain? So this has got a different quality to it. They don't complain it as an aching pain or a throbbing pain. They may use burning, shock-like sensation, numbness. They use some, the patients find it difficult to explain neuropathic type of pain. It's easy to explain a tooth pain or a nociceptive pain. So they find it difficult. They become tongue-tied to explain this nature of pain unless they have a very good vocabulary. Somebody who is very eloquent, they speak well, they always talk, they find a word to explain that. Other people who speak very limited, their vocabulary to explain this type of pain is limited. You know, tara agate doctor, something I feel different. So they use some kind of an odd expression. So there you think of a neuropathic pain. And allodynia, they have hyperalgesia, they have same stimulus, they have more pain. And allodynia, even the touch can feel as a pain. If you have this, they have a neuropathic element to it. Of course, an acute abscess also can have allodynia because there again some amount of nerve sensitivity happens. So a few examples of nociceptive pain, post-operative pain, mechanical low back pain, sports injuries, sickle cell crisis, arthritis. This is the run-of-the-mill patients who come to us. As I had some lift, I fell down, I had a pain. So this is fairly straightforward. So we are all trained very well to treat how to manage this. But this is difficult. Complex regional pain syndrome is like a typical neuropathic pain with lot of autonomic emotional element, trigeminal neuralgia, central stroke pain, peripheral painful neuropathy, HIV neuropathy, diabetic neuropathy can be very painful. We get at least one referral from a physician or a diabetologist who complains of severe pain. They have a high ESR. They're probably examining them. They send them to rheumatologist. Then we find that it is painful diabetic neuropathy rather than a rheumatoid arthritis. And of course, a lot of back pains have a neuropathic element and post-herpetic neuralgia. There are classical neuropathic pains. They don't respond to your NSAIDs. And a lot of other illness, including fibromyalgia and chronic diseases like chronic osteoarthritis, rheumatoid. Most of the patients have an element of nociception and also have some kind of a neuropathic element. Another concept I want to throw here is inflammatory versus non-inflammatory pain. Inflammatory pain, inflammatory diseases, the classical disease, you know, the gout, you can see the classical signs of inflammation. Redness, swelling, pain, warmth, and loss of function. Patients with this type of pain cannot walk. This kind of a swollen fingers cannot use the hand. So this is the typical of inflammatory pain. The pain here is persistent many a times. They improve with a little bit of movement. and contrast this with non-inflammatory pain, or otherwise it's called mechanical pain. You get it in osteoarthritis of the knees or hands. Here swelling is also there, but the swelling, whenever it is there, it is a bony swelling in osteoarthritis. This pain is worsened by activity. Contrast to inflammatory pain. Inflammatory pain, they generally do well. Morning, as people say, as I get up with a lot of morning stiffness, but I do like this 10 times, I feel all right. But in a mechanical pain will get worsened by doing more activities. And they get better with rest. So I have a lot of back pain, I go and lie down, I feel better. This is typical of a mechanical type of pain. In inflammatory pain, they don't get well, that better with rest, and sometimes they are woken up in the night with pain, buttock pain and other stuff. Here, early morning stiffness is of less duration, few minutes, not more than 30 minutes at any cost. But most of the inflammatory pain will have a long-lasting stiffness. And most of the pains, people have a little bit of gelling. Gelling is the first few steps after getting up, they have pain. That phenomenon is called gelling phenomena. That can occur with non-inflammatory pain, that mechanical pain. So we try to differentiate in the clinic whether the patient has got an inflammatory type of illness or a non-inflammatory type of illness. In other words, it's a mechanical type of illness because the treatment is totally different. If you suspect inflammatory disease, you are going to give them more inflammatory drugs, steroids, disease-modifying drugs, etc. A mechanical pain would require, of course, analgesics, activity modification, splinting, physiotherapy, etc. So the management strategies are totally different. Again, I don't know whether it projects well on the screen. This is differentiating inflammatory back pain versus non-inflammatory back pain. So back pain is a common phenomena. All of us would have had some back pain. At the end of probably Chandra update, some of us will have back pain because of prolonged sitting. So inflammatory back pain occurs in younger individuals, predominantly men, younger 40 years. Mechanical back pain, of course, occur in any age, but it's more common in more elderly. Inflammatory back pain occurs at an insidious, slowly it creeps in, but mechanical back pain can be either very, can slowly creep in or can be acute. Pain improves with exercise. Most of the guys say, as soon as I get up in the morning, I'm struggle. Once I get back to work, I can manage all the work. Again, they come back in the night and have pain in the midnight. So that is typical of inflammatory pain. In mechanical pain, activity worsens. They have acute disc prolapse. They try to do something, they have more pain. And pain in the night wakes them in the second half of the night. I'm fine up till 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, around 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm woken up with pain, which is very typical of inflammatory pain. Only differential diagnosis depending upon the age is malignancy. See? And morning stiffness is more than 30 minutes here. Morning stiffness is usually less than 30 minutes. So this is, again, whether it is an arthritic pain or a back pain, we always try to differentiate inflammatory versus non-inflammatory or a mechanical pain because the treatment strategies are different. Another concept I am trying to introduce here is the regional pain concept. We always, patient comes with elbow pain, shoulder pain, knee pain, foot pain, etc. The moment we think of the pain as shoulder pain, like I'm trying to example of shoulder, we think of shoulder pain. So patient comes with shoulder pain, we look at the shoulder, we move the shoulder and try to take an x-ray of the shoulder. If nothing is seen, we take an MRI of the shoulder. Nothing is seen, we are at a loss. If you think of the pain as a shoulder regional pain, then you have a differential diagnosis. The pain can come from shoulder joint. Of course, you know how to examine a shoulder joint. Pain can come from the tendons around the joint. It can be supraspinatus tendinitis or other ligament problems in the shoulder. It can be referred pain from a shoulder joint above. In the case of shoulder, the pain can refer from the neck joints. Some of the facet joints of the neck can refer pain to the shoulder. Shoulder pain can be felt in the elbow. It is always better to include one joint above when you are evaluating a pain in one joint. Say somebody comes to you with knee pain, always include examination of the hip in the examination. So you will pick up a rare patient who has a referred pain from hip presenting to you with knee pain. If you have not examined the hip, you will miss that. The pain can be come from the muscle, anywhere in the trapezium. There are a lot of muscles around the shoulder girdle. The pain can be there from the trigger points in these muscles. And rarely pain can be from the subdiaphragmatic focus or even angina. And pain can have a neuropathic pain. If there is any neck nerve injuries, it can cause, also pain can be projected to the shoulder. C5 lesions can be felt in the shoulder. So if you have a concept of shoulder regional pain, then you will have a differential diagnosis, multiple differential diagnosis, so that you will examine and look at all these factors. Otherwise, if you have a concept as knee pain, you will examine the knee and look for X-ray of the knee and MRI of the knee, and the gut stays stuck there. So you will not, you don't know what to do next. Then you will end up referring the patients to another doctor. So this I have already explained. So always record in your notes shoulder regional pain. That will help us, it will open the differential diagnosis for you. And of course, a few concepts in examination, periarticular versus articular pain. Some of the simple example, I'll use the shoulder as an example. Shoulder, if the shoulder joint pain is there, active movement is what I can do. Passive movement is the examiner can lift more. So active movement is this much, that examiner is not able to improve on it. This is typically a shoulder arthritis pattern, or it can occur in shoulder, like a periarthritis shoulder or a frozen shoulder. Patient can move up to this much, cannot move, but with force you are able to do it. This cannot be frozen shoulder, this cannot be arthritis. It is most of the time it is a supraspinatus tendinitis or infraspinatus tendinitis, it's a tendon problem. So you can be able to differentiate by doing this examination. And of course, pain in single direction. If you have a wrist pain, pain hurts only on this movement, it doesn't hurt on the dorsiflexion, the problem is likely to be a extensor tenosynovitis rather than the wrist pain. Wrist pain, wrist arthritis pain will hurt both on flexion, both on dorsiflexion or flexion. Pardon? So again, neurogenic and non-nociceptive pain I've already discussed. Sometimes you can have acute neuropathic pain presenting to you with swelling and inflammation, particularly when there is acute nerve injury or a complex regional pain. It look like, sometimes it can look like a gout, but it can be an early stage of mononeuritis multiplex. And of course, sometimes we have to also look at the person behind the patient. Some of these pains can be the result of a distress, ongoing acopia in life many a times. And it is exemplified in occupational history. When you look at the occupation is important for all soft tissue. A software engineer is more likely to have some pain in the shoulder, arm. But rather than the type of work, the work satisfaction also contributes to the pain. In an elegant nurses study, they evaluated nurses on the day of joining and after 1 year. Look for back pain. The number one determinant for back pain is work satisfaction. Number two is the type of work. Like the nurses who had to lift patients from different awkward positions came second. So the number one determinant is the work satisfaction. So if you are happy with the job, someone will manage even with the pain, or you would likely to get less pain. It's a very complex phenomenon. This I will skip. There are a few things. When patient comes to us with pain, we have to believe it. As Chandrasekhar was elegantly telling, pain is a perception. If the patient comes to us with pain, we have to believe it even when we are not seeing anything in the X-rays and MRIs. So X-ray may be for us, you don't find anything. You can't question that everything is normal, how can you have pain? As the doctors, we tend to ask these patients because we are frustrated, because we are trying to look for a cause and you don't find a cause. We get irritated. You know, everything is normal, why should you get hurt? But patient does hurt. So when they say it's paining, it's paining. Very, very, very small percentage patient, it is malingering. 99% of the patient, it is real. Even if the pain is due to a psychiatric cause, the pain is real. They feel the pain, and they suffer from the pain. So always respect their feelings and accept it. And accepting the illness is a first step towards building a confidence in the doctor. If you accept, okay, I am ready to accept that you have pain, okay, let us deal with it. So it gives you patients the confidence. And initial medical consults, and I'm sure as primary care physician, most of you have a huge role in determining what's going to become to the patient in the long run. Whether your consultation can medicalize a patient or demedicalize a patient. Somebody comes to you with, for example, I use the back pain as an example. All of you would understand. With acute back pain, I lifted something at a severe catch. I come to one of you. You said, you have an acute back pain, your nerve is twisted like this. Go and take complete bed rest for 15 days. This advice can be, if somebody ignores it and carries on with life, is better for him. If somebody, obedient patient, listens to you, they think their nerve is twisted. Then they'll go and rest. They get to bathroom and walking, the pain will be there. Oh, he'll be thinking that the nerve is getting more twisted. So it gets him into a fear cycle, and bed rest makes all these muscles deconditioned. It is a good recipe for chronic pain. If you have told that, okay, there is some minimum strain on your back, it will go away in a couple of days' time, take this pill, take rest as much as required, do the activities you can, pain will go in a few days. If you have given this advice, you would recover, probably. You would have pain, little pain, you would not mind, you pop up paracetamol and manage your life, and is more likely, you will act, you will continue to be physically active within the limits of pain, he is more likely to recover. So initial consultation has some role in determining whether the patient is going to get into chronicity or not. So we are one of the risk factors for chronic pain as doctors. So remember this when you use the words. And soft tissue rheumatism, women are more prone for musculoskeletal pains. Maybe biological and psychological factors do contribute. Their way of looking at the illness may contribute to the chronicity. And of course, always should look for diabetes, hypothyroidism, and trauma when you are looking at soft tissue problems. Diabetics are much prone for soft tissue problems like flexor tenosynovitis, etc. And there are few things like nociceptive pain arising out of tendon ligamentous are localized. If somebody has a tennis elbow, they almost point it out. I have pain here. When I do this, I get a pain here. So they're fairly localized. Somebody says pain fully here, it is very unlikely to be nociceptive. So general concept, a nociceptive pain is unlikely to cause an entire limb pain. Entire limb pain is either some kind of a neuropathic pain if it is multidermatomal, or they may have a functional or a psychogenic etiology. And another thing is constant unrelenting pain. Somebody comes to you with pain, crying, doesn't seem to get better. You have given him over an injection, patients are not improving. Then only there are three differential diagnoses. Either it can be neuropathy. Acute nerve injury can be so painful and it may not respond to your usual analgesics and NSAIDs. They may require sometimes narcotics, sometimes they may require high doses of gabapentin or something like that. Or it can be ischemic. There is an impending ischemia, the blood vessels, blood supply is going, the tissues are dying because of ischemia. That can be very, very, very painful. They'll require narcotics. They'll get down, settle down only with. So we always look for peripheral pulses. We have missed many times. Acute pain, we go and examine, come back and nothing is there. Take an x-ray, x-ray looks normal, come back and resident, sir, their toes are turning blue. So it was an ischemic pain. If you have not forgot to look at the pulses, you would miss that pain. And if these two are looked at, then it has to be functional. It could be a conversion reaction type of pain. So you have to be aware of that. And always aware of red flags. You need to stress that somebody who is sick with localized pain, always think of malignancies, severe neurological disease, past history of cancer. These are all red flags which you all know. These are the patients who require urgent attention. Somebody has lost weight coming to a shoulder pain, 20 kilo weight, shoulder pain. It's not simple, not going to be a tendon plane or frozen shoulder. There may be malignancy sitting there, or maybe part of a secondaries from somewhere else. I'm going to introduce you to a concept of yellow flags. Red flags are easy. Sick patient, unwell patient, red flag. You do have require more investigations or referral to a center where facilities are available. These are the patients who require your attention. Patient coming to us with bulky files. When they enter into the file, they come with a big file like this. You know that you had it. Because this patient is not going to go for 1 hour. Because they with four sets of MRI, some umpteen number of files from all the rheumatologists from Bangalore and all the neurologists from Bangalore, this patient is going to be a tough patient. We have to identify them early enough. Over depends on medical system. Even if you tell that your pains are better, it will go away in a month's time, come after a month, the next day their pain is not gone, sir. So if you see a personality, they are coming back, even if they are better, but they are not fully gone. They keep coming back for, rather than managing their pain with an SOS, diclofenac sodium or aciclofenac sodium at home, they keep coming for an injection to the medical system. These are the yellow flags. For fear avoidance, because some doctor has told that nerve is twisted, they stop acting, they don't bend, they'll walk like this all the time, they don't even bend. These are the patients, if you identify them, you have to identify them early so that we have to intervene early. Catastrophization. I have a back pain, my uncle also had a back pain and he had a cancer, I'm also going to have a cancer. So this kind of thinking is there, that's a catastrophization. Think, always think that this will lead to the worst. I have a back pain, I'll get paralyzed. I have arthritis, I'll become crippled. So the negative thoughts, catastrophization, you have to identify early. And illness behavior. So when the patient comes to us in the clinic, if they keep on doing like this, they want their, all your attention to that area of pain. So this is called illness behavior. All they always do like this. Sometimes they will even palpate our own neck and tell where the pain is. So this kind of personalities, this is called illness behavior. They want all their attention, all your attention to their painful part. So they don't want you to think of whatever they you ask questions, they keep on coming back to this. And of course, people who have a depression, crying in your clinic, and have a lot of sleep disturbance, these are the yellow flags. If you are able to identify these kind of patients early, intervene early, probably you can prevent them from really getting into chronic and chronic pain and get into invalid state. These patients are famously called as heart sink patients because the moment they come now, all our the energy sinks down. Of course, last few slides I'll run through few important things. When you examine for joints, also look for over mobility. We always look for less mobile joints. Okay, if their pain is there, less is moving less, I think it's arthritis. But always look for hypermobile joints, because hypermobile joints also contribute to recurrent shoulder pains in the form of recurrent shoulder dislocations or subluxations, recurrent knee pain, they get buckling, falling down, they get patellofemoral arthritis, anterior knee pain, enthesitis, they are also prone for enthesitis because they have flat foot, they have prone for back pain because they have either exaggerated lordosis or weak abdominal muscles, they have a flat foot, they can also have intermittent joint swellings due to irritability. They are also more likely to have fibromyalgia or diffuse pains. They are more prone for sprains, aches and pains, sports-related injuries. They are also prone to develop varicose veins and varicose vein-related leg pains, aches and pains. So looking at joint hypermobility is a useful tip for you to pick up these patients. Always look for fibromyalgia ness in this patient. I'll put it a fibromyalgia ness. Vijay Rao was telling about the inflammation is gone, patient is not better. So if you have seen upfront, you have examined them, look for the extent of pain, whether they have widespread pain, look for tender points, you can identify the patients who are going to go through this track. The arthritis is better, but the pains don't get better. And flat foot. Lot of patients go to a doctor with foot pain, they get a foot x-ray, foot MRI, but never asked to stand and nobody sees that they have a huge flat foot. So we are all busy, but still I think few basic tips. We are still clinicians, we are not technicians looking at MRI, and MRI don't give the answer for everything. If you find a flat foot, maybe a good footwear, activity modification is the answer. And flat foot can cause plantar fasciitis, foot tiredness, can cause knee pain, can cause back pain, can contribute to back pain. And of course, when somebody comes to use foot pain, ask somebody whether they wear a high heel footwear. Lot of women do that to look attractive. And if they also have a flat foot and they wear this footwear, it can be catastrophic for the foot. And it can lead to tight Achilles and related plantar fasciitis. So look for hind foot valgus. Hind foot valgus is seen here in this picture. When you see from behind, the foot is falling down, the medial foot is falling down, you can see few toes here. And also another thing which you can always look for is myofascial pain. If somebody comes to you with pain in the neck, severe headache, neck pain, always look for extremely painful, not like areas in the muscle areas. Sometimes if somebody comes to you with headache, ear pain, eye pain, you can find sternocleidomastoid muscle is extremely tender. If you identify somebody comes to us, come to you with the wrist pain, you may find a anterior axillary fold can be very painful. So if you look for trigger points, they can be easily managed with needling and massage. And it can mimic arthritis, it can mimic radiculopathy, it can mimic migraine. This is one commonly missed problem in the clinic. It's supposed to be one of the most common cause for pain in any clinic, but it is hardly looked at and hardly treated. And work-related symptoms, upper limb pains, these are all specific syndromes, tennis elbow, golfer's elbow, medial carpal tunnel syndrome, cramps, these are all very fairly specific disease due to activity. But more difficult to understand is diffuse upper limb pain syndromes. So they have entire leg pain, when they use mouse, they have a pain. You can't identify from where the pain is come, the entire hand cramps. Some of them have posture related issues, correct the posture, they improve. Some of them have myofascial pain syndrome, and many a times it's very, very tough to deal with. Work satisfaction may be more important here than work intensity. You ask directly, I ask question, are you happy with the job? It's very, I'm not getting the promotion, I'm not getting the increments, I'm not able to cope up with. IT field is very, very, very demanding. And the guys who are not up to the mark, see, guys getting into engineering from 50% mark is enough to get into engineering. They get into some more software engineering, they're competing with the guys from IIT. It's a pretty tough field for them, they feel inferior. All this stuff can lead to sometimes chronic pain. And knee pain, always look for hypermobile joints. This is a genu recurvatum. Look for anatomy, genu varum, genu valgus, all these things can cause knee pain in the absence of an osteoarthritis or an inflammatory pain. This is my last slide. Always it is better to hone our history and examination skills. You need to have few simple techniques. When it comes to each area, at least foot pain, you should look for a flat foot. If you are picked up, your job is done. Knowledge gap between what is known and what is practiced is getting huger and huger because of the nature of the vast expansion. So we cannot be masters in everything. I have lost almost entire art of doing general medicine. I am struggling to read my ECGs now. After 20 years of not being a physician, I am struggling to read my ECGs. So the skills are lost. So it is extremely difficult for a general physician or a general practitioner to maintain skills at a high level. So, but for a common illness which you see in your practice, I think you should better to hone a little bit of skills. If difficult, always refer to an appropriate colleague. And make sure that you and your patient speak the same language and understand the disease which you are trying to tell in the same way as you want them to understand. For us, disc prolapse is simple. You know that there is a disc. Disc has slightly bulged towards either the nerve root or the central canal. But when you explain it to them as a twisted nerve, the patient interprets in a different way. So it is the meeting point of two schools of thoughts. The patient's way of thinking about the disease, your way of thinking about the disease is totally different. For us, malaria is simple. You know that it's malaria due to mosquitoes, all these things easier. But for patient, malaria may be totally catastrophic. You would have read that some neighbor has died of malaria. The moment they're going to get scared and crying. So make sure that you and your patient speak the same language and he understands in a way which you want them to understand. Always look for mechanical factors where you can make a difference. Somebody with a slightly unstable knee, giving them a kneecap is enough to make them better. So you look for mechanical factors, this because they are amenable to treatment. Always look for a neuropathic element to the pain, because neuropathic pain requires a different type of medicine. And like you go to gabapentin or amitriptyline will work rather than your NSAIDs. And always look at the person behind the patient, because many a times it is the distress which contributes to the pain. And actively look for psychological distress in patient. Be bold enough to ask about distress. Are you well, all right? Is there everything going well in your home front or in the office front? You can ask straight, do you feel depressed? Do you feel like crying? We feel find it difficult to ask this question. Somehow we have an emotional block or a mental block in asking patients about psychiatric symptoms. But believe me, patients don't mind. Almost 80 to 90% of patients, when I ask the question, they answer yes. So they have no problem in about this, but we have a problem in asking. So we have to change the way we look at these things. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, sir, for that excellent discourse. So now we'll take questions from the house. So while people are thinking about questions, I just wanted to highlight that in the first talk, Dr. Vijaya said that pain is subjective, and Dr. Chandrasekhar said that pain is a perception, and in the third talk, Dr. Dharmanand said that pain is always real, right? So it's subjective, it's a perception, and therefore it is always real. We should never discount a patient just because investigations come back or we are not able to find the answer on a clinical examination. We should never discount the fact that the patient is suffering from pain. We should be empathetic to pain. I think that is one very important takeaway that we have to have from all three talks. Any questions?
Level of vitamin D deficiency, soft tissue rheumatism, and these kind of things.
When the originally vitamin D deficiency concept came, it was very attractive for us. So we thought almost all the pains are going to be vitamin deficiency, and it's going to go away with vitamin D treatment. But vitamin D deficiency is definitely one of the contributing factors for pain in few patients. And vitamin deficiency is so ubiquitous and common.
If all of us have not taken vitamin D supplement recently, if somebody does a study here, I'm sure 100% of us will be vitamin D deficient. And most of us don't have symptoms. Unless it is the critical threshold seems to be very variable in many people. So I don't personally check vitamin D in everybody, but I give vitamin D to everybody. I don't check because it's not costly, because it is 2,000 rupees or 1,000 rupees, and patients go by the number. The test, according to the experts, it is still not very well standardized. Lab to lab variations are not uncommon. We don't know whether the lab is using a best method or not. And patients start worrying about the number. It was 17 last month, sir. It is now 32. Again, they keep checking. They waste money on this. Just give them a vitamin D once a week for 60,000 for 4 weeks, and once a month forever, if possible, unless there's a contraindication. But be aware, every doctor is giving nowadays, because every medical company has got a vitamin D. And we are seeing patients with hypervitaminosis and D and calciuria and all the problems, because people are giving Araquitol 6 lakh units every day for 6 days, every week for 6 weeks, and people are taking it for months together. So what you require is 1,000 to 2,000 international units per day, not more than that. So if you give Araquitol 6 lakhs every week, you are really overloading this patient, and then after that they will give Calcerol once a week. So it is, people are getting overloaded with vitamin D. The vitamin D story is not as exciting as we thought it would be. It is one of the factors. We are vitamin deficiency for various reasons. Optimal vitamin D is important for all of us. I don't think it is a cause for most of the pains. Maybe 2-3% of the pains we may have vitamin D as a root cause or a sole cause.
So thank you very much, sir. And thank you everyone for attending a very nice session. Okay, now we'll have the
Could I have all the speakers of the first session on stage, please? I request Dr. Vijay Das, Dr. Chandrasekhar, and Dr. Dharmanand to share the stage with us. Please accept our sincere appreciation for the outstanding presentations made today. Thank you very much for sharing your time and your experience with us. As an appreciation for the time and valuable input you have shared with us today, we would like to offer this small memento as an effort of appreciation. May I request Dr. Vijay Rao to hand over the memento to Dr. Vijay Das. Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. Sharad Kumar to hand over the memento to Dr. Chandrasekhar. Thank you, sir. May I request Dr. Vijay Rao to hand over the memento to Dr. Dharmanand. Thank you very much, Doctor. Dr. Vijay Rao and Dr. Sharad Kumar, chairpersons for the day, for the first session, we are pleased to have you here and your participation. We also thank you for your contribution today. May I request Dr. Renuka to hand over the mementos to the chairpersons. Thank you very much, ma'am.